hands. Are any of the people in this room godfathers? Anybody a godfather? Keep your hand up. Is anybody a grandfather? Is anybody an uncle? Right? Now, you haven't raised your hand nearly once. Do I need to loan you my son? So what I'm suggesting is you might have a meeting, thank you for doing that, that you would have a meeting where you invite a young person that is connected with you. When was the last time you talked to your godchild? Just one. Bring them in and let them instruct you on how to be up with technology. Maybe it's a matter of you buy a phone for yourself, they're cheap enough, and on that day they instruct you how to turn the darn thing on and set a password, right? So that will be a twofer. It will give you the skills you need to stay in touch as brothers of St. Andrew and would be a moment and a discipleship opportunity. Right? Okay, good. So my task today was to talk about racial reconciliation. And I have a confession to make. I don't believe this is a topic that happens by talking. This is just my bias on this. Particularly given the world that we're in, where there's this thing where we're rejecting politically correct, I call it what our kindergarten teachers and Sunday school teachers taught us, which is how to be polite and nice, but we're rejecting politically correct. And so now people are free to express really what they ought to keep to themselves. Using words and slurs. We saw it sadly come out in the presidential campaign, not just in terms of what those running for office said in general, but what they said about each other and each other's spouses. Disgusting. So I have to tell you, my bias with regard to reconciliation, whether we're talking about issues of race, gender, economic disadvantage and equality, political difference, is about action, it's not about talk. And so my focus for you today on racial reconciliation is going to be around a commitment that I heard our bishop talk about at convention. I was sitting in convention and shocked to my little, threw my stockings down in my shoes and gloried in it to hear that the Brotherhood was going to be engaged in prison ministry. Yeah. I'm not even going to ask you to raise your hands as to who's actively doing that at the moment, because we don't want you to have no shame. So what I want to do is really look at the issues of isms, economic disadvantage, sexism, racism, classism, where it has to do with our system of criminal justice or incarceration. But in order to do that, before I go to that place, I want you to think about who you are. Think about who you are. And when I think about who I am, and if time had permitted, I would have actually had you talking at your tables about who you are. But when I think about my own identity, there are two salient characteristics of my identity. One is that I'm Cecil and Mercedes' daughter. Cecil Broderick, Mercedes Rodriguez, Guerra Broderick. When I was ordained, I remember being ordained in the Diocese of New York and going to a Black Caucus meeting, and the head of the Black Caucus asked me what I was. What are you, Cecily? What are you, Mother Broderick? And I said, what do you mean, what am I? Well, you're going to have to choose. Because if you're going to be, I've been ordained 28 years, if you're going to be in the church, you're going to have to choose. Are you going to be Hispanic or are you going to be Black? And I said to him, am I going to choose to be my mother's daughter or my father's daughter? I am Cecil and Mercy Broderick's daughter. And what that means is that my parents grew up going to church. I didn't have no choice but to go to church. I don't know how to do that with my children the way my parents did it with us, because they look at me and they say, you go on. You know? Or, I'm going, but I'm not staying in church. I'm going to the playroom. Right? You know, and I will fight tooth and nail. It's not quite the level of obedience that I gave my parents that exists today. But my parents raised me to be in the church every Sunday, and my father looked at me and said, my money is my money. My money ain't your money. What you have to give to God is your activism. So I expect for you to pledge yourself. When they ask for money, you say, here am I, put me on the choir. Here am I, let me be an acolyte. Here am I, let me serve at food at the barbecue. But you don't say, here am I, give me a dollar, Daddy, for me to put in the plate. Because it's my money, he said. My mother, very typical Latina lady, was in service. Up until when the church caught up with things, you know, she was on the altar field when we were in a church where they would let brown ladies be on the altar field. She was behind the scenes, helping out with the youth group, cooking, doing whatever. She was of service. And when things changed, and she was encouraged to do so by her rectors, she even served on the vestry later in life. My parents are people of dignity who call upon me to be in church and to be of service. And by going to church, I learned the second part of my identity. That the way that I became Cecil and Mercedes' child is I was first a child of God.
Amen.
And that is my primary identity. Even though my parents gave me birth and formed me, my primary identity is as a child of God. And as a child of God, I will tell you, it has allowed me to navigate the waters of racism, sexism, classism, whatever ism, and stay focused and stay grounded. I did not know, really, now, you know, I grew up in a brown household, I did not know that I was a nigger.
Yeah.
I just thought I was a child until my parents moved us out of Queens. We were members of St. James the Less in Queens. I was a student at the Academy of St. Peter Claver. Anybody remember that school? That was out of Grace Church in Jamaica. I didn't know that I was a black person until they moved us out of Queens to what they thought was the best school district within driving distance of my father's work in Harlem in Scarsdale. And I was out running like all the other children at recess. The bell goes off, you're gonna run to get your favorite place on the swings or the monkey bars. A little boy tripped me and he said, take that nigger. And that's when I learned that I was black, because up till that point, I was just Cecil and Mercedes' daughter. I was not. And I was glad to be grounded in being their child and being a child of God at that point, because it allowed me to be armored and ready for dealing with the world's presumption about what it meant to be a person with brown skin. So I say to you that I'm not a lot in favor of talking about race, because I think the way for reconciliation and harmony in our country is through activism, not through talk.
All right, amen.
And I come to my activism by virtue of who my parents were and my baptism. Mm-hmm. Not my priesthood, my baptism. My priesthood is the work that I do as an extension of my baptism. That was a personal, professional choice of mine. I would be doing what I'm doing, saying what I'm saying, by virtue of my baptism. My priesthood has given me some training for that. So it's important to understand who you are. Because if you don't understand and have come to terms with what the world says about you, vis-a-vis your economic status, your age, the color of your skin, you can't really be about the work of reconciliation. I am a child of God. I am not a nigger or a negress. I am a child of God. I'm not a woman. That's the body I'm housed in, but I am first and foremost the child of God. So when I went to congregation after congregation that didn't want a woman priest, because remember how long I've been ordained, 28 years, right? I didn't worry about that. It didn't trouble me at all because I was a child of God serving in love, and I knew that my commitment in love would be transformative. And so people who didn't want me ended up calling me Mama B. They said, well, what do we call you? You're not father. I said, I certainly am not father. Right? I said, you call me what you want to call me. call me what is reflective of who you know me to be in service to you. So I need for you each to think about who you are, because if we're going to fulfill our calling from the bishop at convention to be a delegation, a posse, a group, a gang, a brotherhood that is going to serve the incarcerated and the family, particularly the children of those incarcerated, and serve them when they come out, you need to know who you are. You need to be secure in your own manhood. So, let me play for you. You will probably hear this better than you can see it, because God has blessed us with a bright sunny day, and I'm not sure how much will actually show up on the screen. This TED Talk, by the way, is on the website of the diocese.
Jails and prisons on death row. I spend most of my time in very low-income communities and the projects and places where there's a great deal of hopelessness. And being here at TED and seeing the stimulation, hearing it, has been very, very energizing to me. And one of the things that's emerged in my short time here is that TED has an identity. And you can actually say things here that have impacts around the world. And sometimes when it comes through TED, it has meaning and power that it doesn't have when it doesn't. And I mention that because I think identity is really important. And we've had some fantastic presentations. And I think what we've learned is that if you're a teacher, your words can be meaningful, but if you're a compassionate teacher, they can be especially meaningful. If you're a doctor, you can do some good things, but if you're a caring doctor, you can do some other things. And so I want to talk about the power of identity. And I didn't learn about this actually practicing law and doing the work that I do. I actually learned about this from my grandmother. I grew up in a house that was the traditional African-American home that was dominated by a matriarch, and that matriarch was my grandmother. She was tough, she was strong, she was powerful. She was the end of every argument in our family. She was the beginning of a lot of arguments in our family. She was the daughter of people who were actually enslaved. Her parents were born in slavery in Virginia in the 1840s. She was born in the 1880s, and the experience of slavery very much shaped the way she saw the world. And my grandmother was tough, but she was also loving. When I would see her as a little boy, she'd come up to me and she'd give me these hugs, and she'd squeeze me so tight I could barely breathe. And then she'd let me go. And an hour or two later, if I saw her, she'd come over to me and she'd say, "Brian, do you still feel me hugging you?" And if I said no, she would assault me again, and if I'd say yes, she'd leave me alone. And then she just had this quality, she always wanted to be near her. And the only challenge was that she had 10 children. My mom was the youngest of her 10 kids, and sometimes when I would go and spend time with her, it'd be difficult to get her time and attention. My cousins would be running around everywhere, and I remember when I was about 8 or 9 years old, waking up one morning, going into the living room, and all of my cousins were running around, my grandmother was sitting across the room, staring at me. And at first I thought we were playing a game. I would look at her and I'd smile, but she was very serious. And after about 15 or 20 minutes of this, she got up and she came across the room and she took me by the hand and she said, "Come on, Brian, you're not going to have a talk." And I remember this just like it happened yesterday. I never looked at her. She took me out back and she said, "Brian, I'm going to tell you something, but you don't tell anybody what I tell you." I said, "Okay, Mom." She said, "Now you make sure you don't do that." I said, "Sure." Then she sat me down and she looked at me and she said, "I want you to know I've been watching you." And she said, "I think you're special." She said, "I think you can do anything you want to do. I will never forget it." And then she said, "I just need you to promise me three things, Brian." I said, "Okay, Mom." She said, "The first thing I want you to promise me is that you'll always love your mom." She said, "That's my baby girl, and you have to promise me now you'll always take care of her." Well, I adored my mom, so I said, "Yes, Mama, I'll do that." Then she said, "The second thing I want you to promise me is that you'll always do the right thing, even when the right thing is the hard thing." And I thought about it, and I said, "Yes, Mama, I'll do that." Then finally she said, "The third thing I want you to promise me is that you'll never drink alcohol." Well, I was 9 years old, so I said, "Yes, Mama, I'll do that." I grew up in the country in the rural South and had a brother a year older than me and a sister a year younger. When I was about 14 or 15, one day my brother came home and he had this six-pack of beer. I don't know where he got it. And they grabbed me and my sister, we went out in the woods, and we were kind of just out there doing the stuff we crazily did, and he had a sip of this beer, and he gave some to my sister, and she had some, and they offered it to me. I said, no, 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 that's okay, y'all go ahead, I'm not going to have any beer. My brother said, come on, we're doing this today, you always do what we do. I had some, your sister had some, have some beer. I said, no, I don't feel right about that, y'all go ahead. And then my brother started staring at me. He said, what's wrong with you, have some beer. Then he looked at me real hard, and he said, oh, I hope you're not still hung up on that conversation Mama had with you. I said, well, what are you talking about? He said, the mamas have all the grandkids that they're special. I was devastated. And I'm going to admit something to you. I'm going to tell you something I probably shouldn't. I know this might be broadcast wrongly, but I'm 52 years old. And I'm going to admit to you that I've never had a drop of alcohol. I don't say that because I think that's virtuous. I say that because there is power in identity. When we create the right kind of identity, we can say things to the world around us that they don't actually believe make sense. We can get them to do things that they don't think they can do. When I thought about my grandmother, of course she would think all of our grandkids were special. My grandfather was in prison during Prohibition. My male uncles died of alcohol-related diseases. And these were the things she thought we needed to commit to. Well, I've been trying to say something about our criminal justice system. This country is very different today than it was 40 years ago. In 1972, there were 300,000 people in jails and prisons. Today, there are 2.3 million. The United States now has the highest rate of incarceration in the world. We have 7 million people on probation and parole. And mass incarceration, in my judgment, has fundamentally changed our world. In poor communities and communities of color, there is this despair, there is this hopelessness that is being shaped by these outcomes. But one out of three black men between the ages of 18 and 30 is in jail, in prison, on probation, or parole. In urban communities across this country, Los Angeles, Philadelphia, Baltimore, Washington, 50 to 60% of all young men of color are in jail or prison, or on probation and parole. Our system isn't just being shaped in these ways that seem to be distorting around race, they're also distorted by poverty. We have a system of justice in this country that treats you much better if you're rich and guilty than if you're poor and innocent. Wealth, not culpability, shapes outcomes. And yet we seem to be very comfortable. The politics of fear and anger has made us believe that these are problems that are not our problems. We've been disconnected. It's interesting to me, we're looking at some very interesting developments in our work. My state of Alabama, like a number of states, actually permanently disenfranchises you if you have a criminal conviction. Right now in Alabama, 34% of the black male population has permanently lost the right to vote. We're actually projecting in another 10 years, the level of disenfranchisement will be as high as it's been since prior to the passage of the Voting Rights Act, and there is this stunning silence. I represent children. A lot of my clients are very young. The United States is the only country in the world where we sentence 13-year-old children to die in prison. We have life imprisonment without parole for kids in this country. And we're actually doing some litigation. Only country in the world. I represent people on death row. It's interesting, this question of the death penalty. In many ways, we've been taught to think that the real question is, do people deserve to die for the crimes they've committed? And that's a very sensible question. But there's another way of thinking about where we are in our identity. The other way of thinking about it is not, do people deserve to die for the crimes they commit, but do we deserve to kill? And it's fascinating. Death penalty in America is defined by error. For every 9 people who have been executed, we've actually identified one innocent person who's been exonerated and released from death row. A kind of astonishing error rate. 1 out of 9 people, innocent. And it's fascinating. In aviation, we would never let people fly on airplanes if for every 9 planes it took off, one would crash. But somehow we can insulate ourselves from this problem. It's not our problem. It's not our burden. It's not our struggle. Well, I talk a lot about these issues. I talk about a race and this question of whether we deserve to kill. And it's interesting, when I teach my students about African-American history, I tell them about slavery, I tell them about terrorism, the era that began at the end of Reconstruction that went on to World War II. We don't really know very much about it, but for African-Americans in this country,
That was an era defined by terror. In many communities, people had to worry about being lynched. They had to worry about being bombed. It was the threat of terror that shaped their lives. And these older people come up to me now, and they say, Mr. Stevenson, you give talks, you make speeches, you tell people to stop saying we're dealing with terrorism for the first time in our nation's history after 9/11. And tell me to say, they'll tell them that we grew up with that. And that era of terrorism, of course, was followed by segregation, decades of racial subordination and apartheid. And yet we have in this country this dynamic where we really don't like to talk about our problems. We don't like to talk about our history. And because of that, we really haven't understood what it's meant to do the things we've done historically. We're constantly running into each other. We're constantly creating tensions and conflicts. We have a hard time talking about race. And I believe it's because we are unwilling to commit ourselves to a process of truth and reconciliation. In South Africa, people understood that we couldn't overcome apartheid without a commitment to truth and reconciliation. In Rwanda, even after the genocide, there was this commitment. But in this country, we haven't done that. I was giving this lecture in Germany about the death penalty. It was fascinating because one of the scholars stood up after the presentation and said, well, you know, it's deeply troubling to hear what you're talking about.
If I can try to catch the video
on the TV. So, well, we don't have the death penalty in Germany. Of course, we can never have the death penalty in Germany. And the room got very quiet, and this woman said, there's no way with our history we can ever engage in the systematic killing of human beings. It would be unconscionable for us to, in an intentional, deliberate way, set about executing people. And I thought about that. What would it feel like to be living in a world where the nation state of Germany was executing people, especially if they were disproportionately Jewish? I couldn't bear it. It would be unconscionable. And yet in this country, in the states of the old South, we execute people. We are 11 times more likely to get the death penalty if the victim is white than if the victim is black, 22 times more likely to get it if the defendant is black than the victim is white. In the very states where there are buried in the ground the bodies of people who were lynched, and yet there is this disconnect. Well, I believe that our identity is at risk. That when we actually don't care about these difficult things, the positive and wonderful things are nonetheless implicated. We love innovation. We love technology. We love creativity. We love entertainment. But ultimately, those realities are shadowed by suffering, abuse, degradation, marginalization. And for me, it becomes necessary to integrate the two. Because ultimately, we are talking about the need to be more hopeful, more committed, more dedicated to the basic challenges of living in a complex world. And for me, that means spending time thinking and talking about the poor, the disadvantaged, those who will never get success. But thinking about them in a way that is integrated in our own lives. You know, ultimately, we all have to believe things we haven't seen. We do. As rational as we are, as committed to intellect as we are, innovation, creativity, development comes not from the ideas in our mind alone. They come from the ideas in our mind that are also fueled by some conviction in our heart. And it's that mind-heart connection that I believe compels us to not just be attentive to all the bright and dazzling things, but also the dark and difficult things. Vaclav Havel, the great Czech leader, talked about this. He said that when we were in Eastern Europe, when dealing with oppression, we wanted all kinds of things, but mostly what we needed was hope, an orientation of the spirit, a willingness to sometimes be in hopeless places and be in with us. But that orientation of the spirit is very much at the core of what I believe even tech communities have to be engaged in. There is no disconnect around technology and design that will allow us to be fully human until we pay attention to suffering, to poverty, to exclusion, to unfairness, to injustice. Now, I will warn you that this kind of identity is a much more challenging identity than one who doesn't pay attention to. It will get to you. I had the great privilege when I was a young lawyer meeting Rosa Parks. And Ms. Parks used to come back from Montgomery every now and then, and she would get together with two of her dearest friends, these older women, Johnny Carr, who was the organizer of the Montgomery bus boycott, amazing African-American woman, and Virginia Dura, a white woman whose husband, Clifford Dura, represented Dr. King. These women would get together and just talk. Every now and then, Ms. Carr would call me, and she'd say, Ryan, the boss is coming to town. We're going to get together and talk. Do you want to come over and listen? And I'd say, yes, ma'am, I do. She said, well, what are you going to do when you get here? And I said, I'm going to listen. And I'd go over and I would just listen. It would be so energizing and so empowering. One time I was over there listening to these women talk, and after a couple of hours, Ms. Parks turned to me and she said, now, Brian, tell me what the Open Justice Initiative is. Tell me what you're trying to do. And I began giving her my rap. I said, well, we're trying to challenge injustice. We're trying to help people who've been wrongly convicted. We're trying to confront a bias and discrimination in the administration of criminal justice. We're trying to end life without parole sentences for children. We're trying to do something about the death penalty. We're trying to reduce the prison population. We're trying to end mass incarceration. I gave her my whole rap, and when I finished, she looked at me and she said, She said, that's going to make you tired. And that's when Ms. Carr leaned forward, she put her finger in my face, she said, that's why you've got to be brave. And I actually believe that the tech community needs to be more courageous. We need to find ways to embrace these challenges, these problems, the suffering. Because ultimately, our humanity depends on everyone's humanity. I've learned very simple things doing the work that I do. It's just taught me very simple things. I've come to understand and to believe that each of us is more than the worst thing we've ever done. I believe that for every person on the planet. I think if somebody tells a lie, they're not just a liar. I think if somebody takes something that doesn't belong to them, they're not just a thief. I think even if you kill someone, you're not just a killer. And because of that, there's this basic human dignity that must be respected by all.
I'm going to pause there in the interest of time. If you go onto the diocesan website and you look for the Lent studies around race reconciliation, you will find this TED Talk. The sheets that I just handed out to you have a wide range of resources. You'll see there's a section of video resources. Brian Stevenson's name is listed on there. All you have to do is go to the library if you don't have a computer at home, type it into the search engine for the internet, TED.com, and it will take you to the TED Talks, and you can look it up, no cost at all. So, I know by virtue of your vow and to the Brotherhood that all of you are already committed to doing the right thing. I know that. The question is, will we, being rooted in our identities, right? My identity roots are with Cecil and Mercedes and being a child of God. Will we not just do the right thing, but will we do the right thing even when it's hard? Earlier, Jeff talked about some statistics about the ratio of males to females in the Episcopal Church. And I just want to, you know, just so you don't feel any sense of performance anxiety, when you look at the people in the pew, for about 100 years, it's always been 30-70. What has happened in the last 10 years, and that is 70% female to 30% male, what's happened in the last 10 years is there's been slippage overall, right? So our overall numbers are down, and the percentage of males has gone down even further, right? So we've always, for whatever reason, right, in organized religion, there has been this differential, and I think it became more uncomfortable for us in the church when we were ordaining women as leaders, because we weren't even seeing a man up front in some congregations, right? But there's always been this differential. The problem now for us is where that differential was, you had 400 members in your congregation, 70% were female and 30% were male. We're now at 80% female or 90% female, 10% male, and the total numbers of members is down to 100. So I want you to look at some numbers. Look at these numbers. This is the international rate of incarceration per 100,000 people. In the United States, there are close to 4 billion people living in the United States. So per 100,000 States, we have 670 per 100,000 who are incarcerated. Are you wondering why people are not in the pew? I can tell you where to find them. Let me show you another number. For those of you who are sitting in the back, this is 1925. This number is 200,000. In 1925, there were less than 200,000 people incarcerated. In 2015, we had a slight decline, so we're around at 105 million men and women and youth incarcerated. And that's not counting the number of people who are caught in the criminal justice system. Because when you look at the numbers of people who are in the criminal justice system, people who are on parole outnumber those who are incarcerated 10 to 1. Are you wondering why there's nobody in church on a Sunday? Okay, look at these numbers. The likelihood in 2001 of a resident, a U.S. resident, we're not talking about our undocumenteds, a U.S. resident being likely to be in prison. Of all men, it was 1 in 9. White men, 1 in 17. Black or African American, 1 in 3. Latino, 1 in 6. Women, all women, 1 in 56. White women, 1 in 101. Black women, 1 in 18. Latino women, 1 in 45. Gentlemen, our mission field. Truly. Brian Stevenson said one of the most critical lessons he learned in life is we are all more than the worst thing we do, right? One of the things that I've learned in life as a female of color, where people have trouble determining what the color is. Am I Hispanic? Am I black? Am I Caribbean? Am I African American? Is that I am more than what my body says. Are we not? So we are all children of God. And as children of God, is there any difference between me and the mother who is writing bad checks to pay her rent? No. So, for what I am encouraging you to think about, and I'm going to hand off to Deacon Nelson now. What I'm encouraging you to think about is that this call or this mandate from the bishop that you should serve the incarcerated, whether they're in jail, under probation, or you're ministering to their children, is that this is an act of reconciliation. You can call it racial reconciliation, or you can just call it reconciliation full stop. Just quickly, these numbers. Look at the numbers of parents in prison, right? Mothers, 2007, 60,000. Fathers, 700,000. Let me give you one more piece of data, because you know where it's always easiest to start with children, right? They, you know, they're small, right? You think you can get the better of them until you spend time with them, and you realize they're going to get the better of you. In 2007, 1.7 million children had a parent in jail on any given day. The number of children with parents in prison increased 80% between 1991 and 2007. Let me give you something else. For you who can't get your children to listen to you anymore and your grandchildren are too busy, nearly half, that is 48% of all parents in state prisons lived with their children before they were sent to prison. So gone is the the mythology that offenders didn't have family connections. 50% of them did. 47% of fathers in state prison lived with their children compared to 54% of mothers, 64% of mothers. 62% of parents in prison and 84% of parents in federal penitentiaries live more than 100 miles from where their children live. 59% of parents in state prisons and 40 45% of parents in federal prisons have not had a personal visit with their child while in prison, and those who do, it has been reduced to video conferencing, where you come to the jail, there's a camera, you're in a room, and then the video monitor plays somewhere else in the prison for your loved one to have a visit with you. There are many places for you to begin with regard to reconciliation. Many, many places. I've provided for you not an exhaustive list, but a full list. I don't want to hear from you that there's nothing going on in Nassau County. St. Joseph's College in Suffolk County has a program where they utilize volunteers and their students so that every semester there's a class where students go in and take the class side by side with an inmate. NYU does the same thing. There are wonderful programs in Brooklyn for the children of people who are incarcerated. All of that's on your sheet. So let's shift over. Bring me your thumb drive so I can get you up on the screen. My urging to you today is to ask yourself who you are, Brotherhood of St. Andrew, and what you can be doing to engage in reconciliation. Yes, my friend.
Yeah, I'm just maybe a little puzzled, but
yep.
I am, in my thoughts, trying to establish what is the trigger that is sending these parents, and including some children, to prison. Because I'm